Framework initiatives. How should we regulate AI? AI development poses significant opportunities in a digitized business environment. But what of the risks? Alexei Dingley, Faculty of ICT, University of Malta. Olga Finkel, WH Partners. Denise Guarda, Z2Dium. Gagan Singh, Cura Network. Moderated by Monty Munford, Forbes.
Good morning, how are you? How's your morning been? Has it been good? What? You can come back. We have quite an interesting subject, and we are one down, which is a shame. If the guy comes, he'll join us. But I've been speaking to these three backstage, and I think we're going to have quite a spicy discussion. I don't think we're going to agree, but hopefully we're going to give something for you to take away. No bullshit, no puff. Tell us who you are for about a minute, each of you, beginning with you, sir, and then we will continue our discussion, beginning with you.
So my name is Denise Guarda. I'm CEO and founder of Studium, and I build an AI and blockchain software called BlocksDNA. And I'm as well working and writing a lot about these things. I have two books coming on blockchain and AI, and I'm working very close with governments and institutions worldwide on these areas.
Thank you. Olga.
Hi, I'm Olga Finkel. I'm a curious individual of being a computer scientist, turning to the dark side and becoming a lawyer. I run the law firm WH Partners, and we squarely focus on new economy, digital economy, and legal and regulatory issues around it.
Hi, I'm Alexei Dingley. I'm the head of department of the Artificial Intelligence Department at the University of Malta. I'm also part of the Malta.ai task force, and I take care of the working group dealing with jobs and education.
Thank you very much. A round of applause, please, for our final attendee. Bravo. Tell us who you are.
Hello.
Yeah, good.
So, sorry for being late. My name is Gagandeep Singh, and I'm an investment banker, an investment consultant, and a growth phase expert. So we help companies grow from an idea stage to an actual company with a business model that turns them into worth millions of dollar valuation. And we work with a lot of prominent people around the globe. And this is just a brief. We can talk more off stage.
Thank you very much. I'm going to start it off with you, sir. Great writer, thought leader, authority, etc. And backstage, you said, AI scares me a lot. Now, that's quite a statement from someone that's in the middle of AI and clearly has access to a huge amount of data. Why do you say that?
Well, my book is called The Next Tsunami, one of my books, and question mark. So I think we are probably in the most challenging time of mankind for various reasons. So it scares me because as an AI technologist, someone that is building AI and someone that is researching, actually teaching as well, one of the things I've been seeing is that no one has actually clue about what is happening. So that's one, the first thing. So if you're not clue, we're already putting all of this in the hands of very few people. So point one. Point two is that there's not only the challenge of artificial intelligence. So at the moment, we only have a very, very inceptional area of machine learning. We're not even in AI. We are in the beginning. But at the moment, even with machine learning, we are already creating bias, fake news, and manipulation of data, and a lot of things that are creating a lot of disruption around the world. If you look at what happened in the last 3 years, it was all created by manipulation of data. From the US elections to what is happening in Europe and a lot of other things that I'm not going to talk. So there's already things happening purely on manipulation of data. But the challenge is then we start applying AI to healthcare, AI to countries. For instance, there's experimentations in countries creating a social score for an entire country. So as you can imagine, if you have a social score for the entire country, who has control of the code of the social score can actually kill people, manipulate people, and do a lot of things. So you can understand why I'm scared. And as well, someone...
Well, it sounds to me that you're scared because it's already happened.
I know, it completely happened.
It's already happened.
No, this is not in 5 years, it's now.
Absolutely.
Yeah. and it's quite scary at that level.
So we're going to have to kind of put our finger into the dike or try and stop the tsunami.
I think not stop the tsunami, we have to surf it, which is not a single thing, because we cannot stop it. Because we are using all the data, we are using all these devices. The problem right now is that 90% of this data, for instance, if you look at Facebook, Facebook has more control of data than in and information and wealth than any time of history of mankind. And 60% of the board of Facebook is controlled by one person, Mark Zuckerberg. I have nothing against the guy, I admire him a lot, but he controls more than any other government, any other person in the planet. And this is just social media data.
Sounds like a James Bond film, right?
It is a James Bond film.
Olga, risk.
Well, I'm quite scared of doomsday as well, and I think it is not possible to stop the tsunami. As you're saying, we have to see what to do about it. And I think now we are in the right time, maybe a little bit late, but still I think in the right time to do something about it.
And how do we do that?
And today, if we look closer to what is happening today and the applications that we use today and the decisions that today's narrow AI, which is very far from being intelligent, in this, the sense of the word that we use for human intelligence, very far, even those quite non-intelligent system taking decisions that make a lot of impact on lives of individuals, of countries, of society, be it election, be it a decision whether I'm going on bail or not, all this affects us. And if we look into this, I think one of the risks that we need to address already, as soon as possible, is the feature of the AI system, especially those based on machine learning, on learning-based AI system, is that it is effectively a black box. There is a decision, it affects us, but we don't know what's inside. It's effectively a black box, and I think it's a big risk that needs to be addressed. And another thing is bias that you already mentioned. Probably the worst thing about the bias is that we are not even aware if it's there. Because if we are aware, we possibly can do something about it. We can train on a different data set. We see what to do about it. But if we are not aware, we cannot do anything about it.
Well, I think it's because the people that create AI are white, and they're men, and they're...
Well, I mean, absolutely. And I think this is something that will differentiate systems developed in different regions and different cultures around the world. The ethics that they have for the system that they accept as a society.
I ran a panel in Bratislava in the summer last year, and I met a UN ambassador, a very young Anglo-Indian girl, about 21. And what she told me, you know, it was insane. There's stories about kind of black guys or Indian guys going to a hand dryer and it doesn't work. The white guy puts his hands in, it dries. I mean, this stuff is mental. Do you know what I mean? Yeah. I think it's the work of the devil, the whole thing. It's terrible, yes, but you're an optimist.
Go to Moral Machine and see that some people prefer to save in driverless cars pregnant women and some people prefer to save dogs. Absolutely. So it says a lot as
no,
well.
No, fair enough. But you're an optimist.
Was it a compliment when you called me fucked up before?
Not you.
Okay.
General. Well, kind of.
No. But the reality is that, you know, AI is here. I mean, it's something which we cannot ignore and it will happen. I'm very much optimist. I mean, if you think about bias, most of the data sets which we use are data sets which existed before as well. So probably there was bias already. It's just that we didn't know that it was a biased data set. But now, also thanks to AI, we're realizing that it's biased. It's true that there are these issues, and that's why there are new fields like explainable AI, whose task is precisely to explain why the AI took that decision. So we're moving away from these black boxes. Of course, most of the AI, especially when you speak about deep learning, which is the most advanced at the moment, is pretty much a black box. But we're looking into that black box to open that black box and understand why certain decisions are being taken.
Can I ask you what you mean by black box? Like a Pandora's box?
A black box? No, it's not a Pandora's box.
Well, it probably is.
But technically, they're learning systems where you give it an input and you give it an output. Of course, we're training them, but we're not sure what's happening inside there. Right. So why is the AI taking a particular decision and not another decision? So we have to be careful over there. But if we go for the explainability element, I'm sure that we can tackle many of these issues. If you take a look, for example, at what's happening within the space of the self-driving cars at the moment, it's true there's bias. For example, one of the biases which exist at the moment is that a self-driving car is more prone to kill a colored guy than a white guy, as you correctly pointed out. But when you see as well the number of incidents which there have been with regards to self-driving cars, It's pretty much low. Of course, there are issues, but worldwide, there's 10, 20 accidents, fatal accidents. When you consider that globally, there's more than 1.2 million accidents which are fatal because of human drivers, of course, then you start to compare the difference. Listen, AI is not there yet, and we're very far away. You mentioned Doomsday before and the Terminator. We're very far away from there, and unless we have more powerful machines, which might come, by the way, but at the moment, unless we have more powerful machines, it will take us a lot of time to reach over there. However, there's another important aspect. For example, once again, in the element of self-driving cars, if you take the training sets of self-driving cars, they've reached 60 years of driving. Now imagine, nobody over here can claim 60 years driving experience. At most, we can have 3 to 4 years. So they're improving all the time. But we still have to get there, and it will take us a lot of time.
OK, well, it's nice to hear you not fucked up, and it's good to know you're
thank you.
Go on, Deep. You're a Sikh guy, presumably. I've driven a car around Amritsar for a few days, and I really could have done with some AI helping me driving around that city. Where do you stand? You're an optimist, pessimist?
See, what I feel is that AI is bringing a lot of change around the globe. And we need AI for sure. Like, it's helping in healthcare, it's helping in a lot of spaces. But then there's always public anxiety when a new technology comes up. And it's similar to this case as well. And very prominent people around the globe, they have said, and certain researchers, they have said that they're just similar to nukes. Like, a government will never allow someone to play with nuclear power and without regulating it. And if it goes out of hand, it is destructive. The same way AI technology works. If you don't regulate it, then it will just work in the same manner. It will be far more destructive than nuclear power, to be honest. We have heard that AI probably makes you think, what is artificial intelligence? Artificial intelligence is when you're not able to make out that whether the answer from front is like made from a computer or a human. That's what basically Turing test also says. So, and once that happens, you're just making a new thing that will think maybe much better than humanity, and you have no control over it. So, of course, we need regulation over it, and of course, we need AI. So we can't just simply stop it. We have to regulate it.
So, okay, so let's keep that going then.
I definitely don't agree with regulation. Of course, there have to be some specific pockets for regulations, like, for example, safe self-driving cars. But if we place regulation at this moment, we will kill all the AI research. Okay, so we need to give the freedom to AI researchers.
But
of course, there have to be some safeguards. Okay, like I like to describe this as if when men discovered fire, no, it was this incredible thing given to us by the gods. A lot of people did not explain fire, did not understand fire, and then slowly we tried to understand it, harness its power, and of course use it in the best way possible. And AI, it's exactly the same. We've just discovered fire, or AI, whatever you want to call it. Some people know how to use it, utilize it. We have to spread it, but we have to be careful as well.
Well, maybe some people are going to get burnt by it.
There will be people as well.
Exactly.
Let's carry on regulation, because that's the topic. It appears that we have a runaway train here, and we need to put some tracks and some signals and boxes on there. In my opinion, I think that's totally right. Do you believe how do you think regulation will affect it, and how should it be done?
See, regulations are done in a way like every single industry is regulated. You keep a safeguard, you keep a watch on it, and you set some certain codes of conduct, basically. And this is how it will work in this artificial intelligence as well. Like, you have to take care, like, at what scale the research and development is being done. And yeah, this is.
But I mean, I disagree with you. If just because there's regulation doesn't mean it stops creativity.
Well, depends on the amount of regulation.
Let Olga.
Just have different interpretation of what the word regulation means. Regulation does not mean and does not need to be mean a straitjacket, right? Yeah. The creativity should be there. And I think we should remember that law and regulation itself does not really regulate technology, never. It regulates functional relationship in society between various individuals and entities in the society. And what it tries to do, regulation, is tries to preempt and prohibit or inhibit negative outcomes. So that's exactly what we need to do. We need to see what potential risks are, what kind of negative outcomes, and some of them can actually be unknown, and this is the problem, and try to
So we need a sweet spot, right? Between creativity and regulation and behavioral change. Dennis?
I'm more radical. Okay, so I not disagreeing with what was said. So I think the problem you mentioned, fire and the regulation, but the challenge is that. So if you look at from a pure construction of artificial intelligence or machine learning, which we are still in the basics, like you said, at the moment there's 10 companies in the world that control all the production of creation of artificial intelligence worldwide. And these companies not only control the creation of artificial intelligence, but they create as well the data that comes out of this creation. And the very important thing is that if you look at the history of mankind, when the fire was invented, there was still an evolution of mankind. At the moment, for instance, I have a multimillionaire that I work with that spent $1 million to rejuvenate his body using the most advanced technology. We are creating superhumans now. So I'm sorry, I want to be even more bombastic on this, and I want to alert, because this is advancing very, very fast.
Alert,
and I'm as well an academic, so I'm researching as well this. But my point is that there's a total lack of consciousness about this. So the regulatory part needs to be on the civic part of each of us. First, just an example to finish, and I will be polemic, but I want to be. So the Brexit. I live in the UK. The Brexit was a manipulation of data to change the opinion of the UK population. Done with Cambridge Analytica data, that manipulate psychology using Facebook data. This is a fact, okay? This is not fake news. It's a scientific fact. What was done about this? Zero. We're still moving forward, not me, but moving forward with the Brexit, with a complete chaos. The country is totally divided. The ultra-nationalists went to the top. And now we have this situation where the country is in the verge of civil war. Not in a war, but a psychological war. So this is a fact. So the regulators and the governments have to work together to try to look at this very serious. And this is all of us, okay? We have as much responsibility as our governments, because if we just don't do anything, special people like us in this room, and that's why I'm writing books and I'm trying to work with governments.
No, I get it, and I hate to mention the word Brexit. AI destroyed the UK, maybe. Terribly depressing. You were going to say something, going to.
Yeah, actually, I just want to add to the regulation part, and what he said that we have to keep it open, an open space too, so that research and development and progress can be made. And who would be the ones to oppose it? Top corporations, maybe Elon Musk, Bill Gates. But they are the ones who said that artificial intelligence is growing at such pace that it is going to have like 3,000 times the impact of Industrial Revolution. And it's happening like 10 times the scale of the same. So they are the ones who are talking about it, and they're accepting it, that with the executives and the corporations are accepting it, and they need some regulation. They're urging for it.
But so when it comes to regulation, if when it comes to AI and blockchain island, Malta, but sometimes some countries or some sectors are going to get an advantage because they offer loose regulation. Is that a problem when it comes to the evolution of AI and the blockchain, actually?
Well, it can be a problem, no? I think the issue with AI is that it's very different from blockchain. Blockchain needed regulation. But in the case of AI, it's so diverse that probably each and every one of you over here have some sort of AI. Here in your pockets, at your home, whatever. So the issue is, how do you regulate that? I mean, it's impossible. And that's why I'm saying, listen, regulation has to be very specific to specific tasks. You can't just do a carpet regulation on AI. It just won't exist. And remember, every day we're finding new and different functions for AI. And that means that we have to look at individual cases on a case-by-case basis.
I agree that we need to look into individual cases, but we also see the big picture. We must see the big picture, otherwise we'll never preempt the doomsday that we're talking about, so we have to do it. And zooming in maybe to a detail, I think if I can single out one thing that I would want to see in the regulation is that the principle that the proverbial buck stops with someone, not with something, but with someone. Because if it's something abstract system that doesn't have a concept of understanding of what loss of human life is or freedom, then it's completely useless at all. So this kind of parameters we must have. But at the same time, we should not delude ourselves and think that it's easy to do. I think it's much more difficult to do comparing with blockchain or anything else for the reasons of the nature of AI. And we need to control it somehow. We need to try to, we're talking about in Malta, potential of certification of the system. Yeah. But I think it's much easier said than done, because if the systems will be more intelligent than we are, how exactly are we supposed to certify them? And also they are changing absolutely. All the time.
Well,
and
Dennis
the data changes
all
the time. So we have to be cautious about that.
Making the example of Brexit. I mean, can you give us some leading lights here? Are there any people doing anything about regulation? Is there anything awesome that you think's happening or you've seen?
I think maybe we're
over time. It seems like a pretty important
panel.
There's
a global AI group that's made up of some big corporations, and they're working on regulating it, and they're working on keeping a track of how things and advancement are done. So, yeah, people are getting aware of it and they know about it. It's just the cases that you just don't need to apply too broad a brush to it, and you have to keep a track.
Right, okay.
And I would add that governments are critical here, okay? Because the problem, I run a corporation, so I'm the two sides, and I teach as well. So,
and you work with countries as well, right?
I'm actually developing the AI strategy for a country, yes.
Wow.
But the point here is that my challenge as a citizen is that this, and like you mentioned very well, is that we have to take conscience about this, because at the moment, the tsunami is going, and a very important thing just to finish, we have human to human relations right now, human to machine. Everyone here is at the moment is using human to machine, and machine to machine. So these three operations are working as we speak. So at the moment, the machine to machine is the scariest part, and this right now unstoppable. But the point is that the two other parts have to be prepared right now. So the governments and the regulators and the corporations have to work together. But the problem is that the world right now is run by a couple of corporations.
No,
so, and even the academics right now are sponsored by these corporations. Yeah. So we need to action. And this is a work of all of us.
I'm not.
No, I'm not at all. I'm talking about big research.
We're way over time. Yeah. Final words, sorry. So I'd talk to you all night long. Final words.
Regulation is important, but I think the ethical underpinning of it is perhaps even more important. Yes. And the wider strata of society should work together.
Absolutely.
On getting it right.
Definitely. I agree with Olga, what she just said. We have to be very careful. Of course, it's an uncharted territory, but we have to tread very careful so that we ensure, of course, the safety of the people, but without strifing the development of AI.
But AI might be kind, and then AI might fix the bad AI.
Probably.
Who knows? Fantastic conversation. Thank you for your time. You're available afterwards. Please, a round of applause. Thank you. Fantastic.